I'm going to try to do three things that are fairly different from each other, but all within Ramsey theory. So Ramsey theory, to recall, is the collection of problems where you have some colouring of some object, and you're looking for some very structured subset. You're saying if your initial object is very, very large and coloured in an arbitrary way, however it's coloured, you can find the nice small object you're looking for. So last time we were looking for monochromatic cliques, and okay, we're going to start out doing that, and then later on we're going to move on to some slightly more complicated objects, not much more complicated, arithmetic progressions. And see that the techniques are a little bit different. And part three is going to be a little bit harder to follow, a little bit more complicated, so it's very important that you ask questions. So I want everyone to try and ask at least one question today, if you can. It doesn't matter if it's a stupid question, because that'll just tell me that you're not following. And probably if you're thinking the question, at least five other people are thinking the same question. So please try not to feel embarrassed. Okay, I'm going to start out with something fairly simple, but extremely important. So the title of the course is Extremal and Probabilistic Combinatorics, and probability is going to be, as the weeks go on, more and more important, a more and more crucial tool. I don't mean complicated things from probability theory, I mean just the way of thinking probabilistically, thinking about things in a random way. So you'll see this example. It's a very useful idea. And this is the first time it was used in combinatorics. Okay. So remember the definition of R of K, which is the Ramsey number of K, which is the minimum n such that if you have a coloring of the edges of Kn with two colors, so you have the complete graph on n vertices. You have n vertices, each pair you color either red or blue, 0 or 1. Then there must exist a monochromatic copy of Kk. It's saying, when k is 3, it's saying how many vertices do you need so that when you red blue color the pairs, you find a monochromatic triangle. And last time we saw the answer was 6. If you have 6 or more vertices, however you color, then you can find, perhaps I'll draw that picture again. Number and remember, so we take 6 vertices, however we color the edges, we know that each vertex must have 3 of the same color coming out of it, and those 3, well, if that's blue, you have a blue one. And you're stuck with this edge. Whether it's blue or red, you have a monochromatic triangle. Okay, so this is a monochromatic triangle. So you should tell me if I'm going too fast or too slow. But anyway, just to remember the definition. And what we proved last time, which it was actually proved by Erdős and Szekeres in 1935, is that R of K is at most 4 to the K, basically. We actually proved it's at most 2K choose K, which is roughly 4 to the K. Okay. So proof last time. So the question is, how close is this to the truth? is the Ramsey number really exponential, or is it maybe much smaller? Is it polynomial? Is it linear? So what do you have to do to prove a lower bound? Well, you have to come up with a coloring of the edges of the complete graph on n vertices, which has no monochromatic clique on k vertices, where n is as big as possible, where n is polynomial in k or exponential in k. It turns out this is very difficult to do, that even to come up with a... So this theorem was proved in 1935, and almost immediately they asked this question, is it best possible? And it wasn't until about 1980 that someone constructed a super polynomial lower coloring. So a coloring of a super polynomial number of vertices with no complete monochromatic KK. It's very hard to do. Nevertheless, Erdős proved, more or less that date, following bound Ramsey number is exponential in k. So the two things I just said probably sound like they contradict each other. So it's very hard to construct colorings with no monochromatic kk, and it wasn't done until 1980, but in 1947, nevertheless, Erdős proved an exponential lower bound. So, the obvious conclusion, this proof is not constructive. So in that case, how did he do it? The proof is both extremely important and influential and one line. Okay, so perhaps to explain it, we'll take a few lines, but to someone who works in combinatorics, in probabilistic combinatorics these days, then no one would say more than three or four words, perhaps two words, to do this proof. So you want to color the complete graph on this many vertices such that there's no monochromatic clique of size k. How do you want to color? The hint is perhaps over there. I didn't know. This proof is going to be two words. The first one is color. The second is how you're going to color. Randomly. It's a probabilistic argument. Let's color randomly. I mean, what a silly idea. We haven't, it's what send a monkey in to color it. That's how he'd do it. Well, it turns out he'd do it pretty well. Okay. So what does this mean? Okay. So we color randomly, I mean that for each edge, the probability that the color of the edge is red, 1, equals 1/2. For all edges, and all independently. Okay. So for each edge, you toss a fair coin. If it comes up heads, you color it red. If it comes up tails, you color it blue. Do this for every edge independently. And now we're going to count how many monochromatic KKs we expect to have. Okay. The expected, okay, well, let's say XK is going to be a random variable. So I don't know how much probability everyone has seen, so please ask me if the terms are unfamiliar, but I'm only going to use very basic ideas. So it's a random variable, and just counts the number of monochromatic KKs in KN under this coloring. Okay? So you have this random coloring, and for every realization, this takes a number. So each number occurs with some probability. And I want to count the expected value of xk. So what's the expected value of xk? Well, a very nice property of expected value, which is why we'll deal with it a lot exactly because of this property, is that it's linear. So to count the expected number of monochromatic KKs, you look at every potential one, look at its probability, and add them up. Okay. So this is just the sum over all subsets of, let's say, of n of size k of the probability that S forms a monochromatic KK. Okay. This is just almost the definition of expected value. So what's the probability that S forms a monochromatic KK? You have a set of K vertices. And so it's a monochromatic KK if all of the edges inside it are the same color. Well, how many edges are there inside KK? K choose 2. Okay. So number of pairs of vertices. And each of them you're flipping a fair coin. Sorry? So yeah, it's just...
It is 1/2.
So it's equal to, so the same sum of S equals K. Of what do you want to say? 1/2.
For the number of S.
Mm-hmm. Which is K choose 2. Almost. So each edge has to come with the same color, but there are two possible colors.
Times 2.
Exactly. Exactly, times 2. Or minus 1. Same thing. Yeah? Okay? Questions? Or everyone happy? Good. So you toss K choose 2 coins. The probability they all come up heads is 1/2 to the K choose 2 minus 1. Good. Okay. So now this doesn't depend on S. So the sum of these things of this over the S's is just the number of choices of S. So it's equals N choose S times 2 to the minus K choose 2 plus 1. Okay. No, sorry. Thank you. Okay? And I claim when n is root 2 to the k that this is less than 1. So, okay, perhaps I should do this calculation. So this calculation is very simple once you're used to it. So these kind of calculations, these problems, you get the same calculation basically every time, and you do the same thing. So here's just a typical way of doing this calculation. So you use the fact n choose k is a most en over k to the k. So perhaps you've seen this before, perhaps not. If not, it's very easy to prove just from the definition of n choose k. So from the formula n factorial over k factorial n minus k factorial. So it's a very simple property. And so n choose k times 2 to the minus k choose 2 plus 1 is at most, well, let's take the 2 out, en over k times 2 to the minus k minus 1 over 2 to the power k. Right? So this is just 2 to the k times k minus 1 over 2. Yeah. Just took the power of k out. And now if n is 2 to the k over 2, then that cancels with this 2 to the k over 2. And what do we get? 2 times... root 2 e over k to the power k. Okay, this is less than 1 if k is at least, I don't know, 5 or something. Okay, so let's not worry too much about k being very small. Okay? So in fact, you get something slightly better if you calculate more carefully. You get something like this divided by k, or divided by root k. But anyway, let's not worry. Okay, so what we've shown is the expected value of this random variable is less than 1. Now here comes the key idea, in a way. If the expected value of a random variable is less than 1, there has to be a positive probability that it actually is less than 1. Okay. This implies that the probability xk is less than 1 is positive. Maybe I'll Okay. So this calculation here, the expected value is less than 1, implies there must be some positive probability that you're less than 1. Because if you are always at least 1, then your expected value has to be at least 1. Right? The contrapositive is completely obvious. But what does it mean for, well, xk is the number of somethings, so it's an integer. That means with positive probability, it's 0. Which means there exists some coloring such that it's 0. But that's exactly what we want. This theorem says there exists a coloring if of kn, if n equals root 2 to the k, such that xk is 0, such that there is no monochromatic kk. So that's the end of the proof. So, okay, the proof is either one line or two boards, depending on how much detail you want to give. But this is really the idea. And this idea will come back many, many times in the course. Okay. And perhaps I should say, so are there any questions about the proof? So the bounds root 2 to the k proved in 47, 4 to the k proved in 35 are basically still the best known bounds on this function. that there was an improvement in this bound by a factor of 2 in the 70s, and there was an improvement on this bound of, I forget, maybe a factor of k or something in the 80s, and then very recently this was improved by an arbitrary polynomial, so by k to the constant for any constant, which note is much worse than improving the 4 to a 3.999, but at least it's something, and that was published in Annals of Math and was proved by a guy called David Conlon, who will be giving a mini course in a few weeks' time. So I highly encourage everybody to come to his mini course. He's a really brilliant young guy. So he has the record upper bound. But this is sort of one of the most famous and most frustrating problems in all of combinatorics, that the question is so simple, and yet we can't really get anywhere close. That this root 2 and this 4 are telling us that somehow we don't understand something about graphs. Anyway, this is a good problem to think about, but maybe for not too long. So this problem, Tim Gowers, who's a Fields medalist in Cambridge, would give to all of his, whenever he got a really good student, he would give them this problem. Partly because they might solve it, and in the end David did make some progress, but mainly just to let them know that they weren't quite as brilliant as they thought they were. Okay, let's before the break, talk a bit about Ramsey for K-sets. So I'm going to tell you first about...
First, come with a question.
Okay.
Or a problem. Show that given any 5 points in R squared, there exist 4 of them which form a convex quadrilateral.
Doesn't look related, but I promise you it is. Okay, so first you can solve this. So I'm given any 5 points. I want to find 4 of them which are convex, so meaning all the angles are... Sorry? Thank you.
No 3 collinear.
Thank you. Does collinear have? No, just 1 L, I think. Any ideas? Well, if we look at the convex hull, if that has at least 4 points in it, then you're already done. Because those 4 points form a convex quadrilateral. The convex hull is if you send lines in from infinity where you get stuck. So the only case you have to worry about is when the convex hull is a triangle. And the other two points are somewhere inside. So how to finish it? You have a triangle, you have two points inside, you want to show that you can find a convex quadrilateral. Wherever those two points are. Draw a line. Exactly. And draw the straight line between them. Because Mo3 are collinear, it has to hit two of the sides, and you take the corresponding two points. Okay. Very nice. So, what's the obvious question? So, in mathematics, and especially in combinatorics, asking questions is as important as solving them. So you should, every time you see something, you should try and think, every time you solve something, you should think, what's the next question? Exactly. So, show that
if n is sufficiently large,
that wherever you put these n points, you can find k of them, which form, okay, don't form a convex quadrilateral, are in convex position. So form a convex k-gon. This was a problem given to, well, in the early 1930s, there were some Hungarian youngsters living in Budapest who really liked mathematics. And so they would meet up sort of every few days, and they would try and solve math problems together. They would talk about mathematics. And three of them were called Paul, George, and Esther. And Esther showed up one day with this problem, that she had solved the case that we just did, and she wondered if they could solve this question together. And I don't know if it was the next day or the next week or when, but George came back and triumphantly told them, I have the solution. And I think the solution was the one I'm about to show you. And Esther was so impressed that she ended up marrying George. And they stayed married until, they both died in the 1990s. So they were together for 60 years. And that's why it's called the happy ending problem. Paul, I don't know if Paul was in love with Esther or not, but Paul never married. But he did solve lots of really good math problems. He was okay. Paul was Edish, and George was Sengarish. So this is George's solution. So here's the theorem, and it's now known as Ramsey for K-sets, because unbeknownst to them, it had been proved 5 years earlier in England by Ramsey. But anyway, the theorem says, for all k,
if n is sufficiently large, then, and you have a coloring of the k subsets of 1 up to n with two colors, say, then there exists, oh, so I realize that I'm using k in two different ways, so I'm going to use a monochromatic complete, let's say, M set. So, I apologize, my k here is not really the same as the k here, but hopefully you'll forgive me. Okay. So what do I mean by this? So this is a set A such that the color of B is the same for all subsets B of A of size k. And the size of A is m. So for all k and m. Okay. Okay, so did anyone manage to prove this over the last 2 days? Yeah? We'd like to show. You don't have to, but if you'd like to. Okay. Okay, cool. Okay. So, proof is going to be by induction, again. Induction's a very useful tool, by induction on k. Recall that for k equals 2, it follows by Ramsey's theorem. Okay. So for k equals 2, we saw the proof last time. How about for larger k? Well, let's say k bigger than 2. And let's pick a vertex, arbitrarily, as before. And let's consider this is the rest of the graph. We have some coloring. So we're given a coloring of the k subsets with red and blue. And, well, we're going to use induction on k. So what we'd like is a coloring on the k minus 1 subsets of the graph. So what's an obvious way to do that? I picked a vertex. I want a coloring of the k minus 1 subsets of the rest of the graph. Well, for any k minus 1 subset, this set plus v has some color. So let's take that. So set, so define C prime. So C prime is going to be the coloring of the k minus 1 subsets of n minus 1. So maybe V is n to 0, 1 by Maybe I'll call it, whatever, I'll call it V, doesn't matter. C prime of S equals C of S union V. And I'll do it, write it properly. Okay. Okay. So I've forgotten what I'm doing, but let's see what happens, okay? Hopefully we'll figure it out as we go along. Okay.
But in the induction hypothesis, we have an infinite set in which all the k minus 1 subsets are monomorphic.
Very good. So here we're actually doing the finite case, but basically the same. So we have an arbitrarily large set, which is monochromatic. So if by the induction hypothesis, yeah, sorry, I think I gave you as homework the infinite version and now I'm doing the finite version, but the proof is basically the same. By the induction hypothesis, there exists a arbitrarily large monochromatic subset of n minus 1. So let's call it A1. I'm going to find in here say A1 has size N1. And by picking N very large, we can make N1 as large as we like. Right? So we're going to want N1 to be really big, but for any N1, there exists an N which works. Okay? That's what the induction hypothesis says. Okay. So what does it mean for A1 to be monochromatic? It's monochromatic in C prime, which probably I should call C1. So that means that for any, so i.e., for all subsets of A1 of size k minus 1, the color of B union V is the same. Right? What it means for A1 to be monochromatic in C prime. I mean, I probably should have called it C1, actually. Let's call it C1. So any B in here, the size k minus 1, if you add V to it, look at the color, it's the same. So this should remind you of the proof of Ramsey we saw last time, that we picked a vertex and we wanted it to only send red edges forward. Okay. Then we picked another vertex and it maybe only sent blue edges forward, and so on and so on. So now it's just the same thing. Okay. So we could think of this as this vertex only sends red edges, say, forward in A1. So think V1, let's call it V1 as well, only sends red edges forward in A1. So now we just repeat the proof before. So let's pick a vertex V2 in A1, define a coloring C2 of A1 minus V2, choose K minus 1, I guess. So I see two ways to go forward now. I'm not sure which is better. So we could define C2 as being the color of the set just with V2, or we could define it as the color with V2 and V1 and use induction at the K-2 level. But then we're going to be stuck because they might be different colors. Is that right? No, then they all have to be red. So that'll be boring. Okay, so we have to do it this way. Good. Okay, then define it on the K-1 sets by saying C2 of S is equal to the color of S union V2. Okay. And by the induction hypothesis, there exists a monochromatic set, which is very large. Perhaps I'll start over there again. By the induction hypothesis, exists a monochromatic A2 subset A1 in coloring C2. Of size n2, where we can take n2 as large as we like, as long as n1 is sufficiently large. And n1 can be as large as we like, as long as n was sufficiently large. So by taking n as big as we need, we can make sure that all of these other numbers are also as big as we need. And in fact, okay, by defining the Ramsey function, you can really write these down and see what they are. Okay. And then we continue. As before, we get a sequence V1, V2, V3, as many as we like. Well, how many do we need? 2k-1, I think. Okay. We continue for 2k-1 steps. thank you. Thank you. Yep, I'm getting my, it was a mistake to have k as in my brain in two different ways. Thank you. So, take 2m-1 steps such that each vertex sends forward only edges of a certain color. J sends forward edges of only one color. So each edge in this set, the color is determined by the guy on the left, by the VJ with J smallest. And now we're done, because just like last time, at least half of these have to send the same color. and they form a monochromatic M set. Questions? No questions because everything is clear, or no questions because everything is so unclear that you can't even think of a question to ask? It's either very good or very bad. But I don't know which, quite seriously. Okay. So the proof is basically the same as we saw last time, except this idea that you need to induce the coloring at one level below. But actually, that's really what we were doing last time. If you think about it, we were saying, who do you send red edges to? Call them red. Who do you send blue edges to? Call them blue. One of those two sets must be big. We're using Ramsey's theorem for one set, which is just the pigeonhole principle. So this whole thing is just, it's a higher dimensional generalization of the pigeonhole principle. Basically. Okay, so let's solve the happy ending problem before we take a break. Let me write this again. While I'm writing it, you can think how to prove it. So, theorem, the happy ending problem. So I think this appeared in a paper by Edison Zekeresh. But they do some other things as well. I think the proof is due to Zekeresh. So what does it say? For every k existent n such that any n points in R squared, no three collinear, contain K in convex position. And the hint is, we're going to use Ramsey for K-sets. So you have n points, and they're somewhere in the plane, and you'd like to define a coloring on them which, such that a big monochromatic set will be useful. So what coloring would you like to use? You want it to be something to do with convexity, right? So given a set of k points for some k, so first you have to pick k. If they're convex,
I think k must be
3. Okay.
Convex is basically a set of triangles.
Right, so if things are in convex position, then you can triangulate them, that's true. But then what color are you going to give a triple?
Same color.
The same color, but all of them the same color?
Yes.
So, but then how is Ramsey going to help?
I think 3 and N. M?
Uh-huh.
yeah. is M and K.
But if they all have the same color, then
two colors.
What's the other color? So yeah, so how are you deciding if a triangle is red or blue? But we're getting closer. So with triangles, it's not really clear what, I mean, every triangle is a triangle, right?
So, square.
Okay.
If it is convex, one color, it's
not convex. What? Where am I red and blue? Here we go. This one is red, this one is blue. Any four points, either they form a convex quadrilateral or they form a triangle with a point inside. Those are the only two options. So we can give one of these color red, the other color blue. So we've now got a two coloring of the four sets in our endpoints. Okay? Every set of size four has a color. So by Ramsey, there exists an arbitrarily large monochromatic clique. Okay? So by Ramsey exists an M clique. Or okay. Let's call it a K clique, given that's what we have. Monochromatic. So if it's red, then suppose it's a monochromatic red K clique. So you have K points, and every four of them form a convex quadrilateral. Does it follow that all of them are in convex position? Maybe I'll do this over here. Well, suppose not. Suppose you have a whole bunch of them in convex position, and then one inside somewhere. Can you find a blue edge? I don't do three on a line, do I? That's a better point. Sorry? Yes, because you already said the answer before. We can triangulate. Exactly. And exactly. It must lie in one of the triangles because it's not on any of the lines. And that triangle plus the point is a blue edge. Then, done. Where's my blue? Blue edge. Okay. Triangulate. Okay, but what if it's blue? That's my blue. What happens if instead we have a monochromatic K clique where all the four sets are blue? So given any four elements, they form a triangle with a point inside. Right, it's not possible, but why?
Because if you take the three of them on the outside, then all the others should be inside that triangle.
Okay.
And then you take three inside the triangle and one outside, and I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Can't you find the triangle that is on the most inside?
The most inside triangle, but where's the fourth point? It could still be, all the other points could form a four set. Yeah. Exactly. We already saw the answer right at the start. Any five points contain a convex quadrilateral. This is a red edge. That's my red. Yeah. It's not possible to have a complete blue monochromatic clique on at least 5 points. Because we saw at the start, any 5 points contain a convex quadrilateral. Yeah? The convex quadrilateral is red. Okay. So the final step of the proof was the easy exercise at the start. Okay. So done. Cool. Good work. Questions? No? Okay, well, let's take a 5-minute break and then I'll